Yeah, so yeah, Evie will
tell about can we trust directional information from CRMs in nature?
Yeah, sorry, it's quite a scary title, but I've never had a reason to use one like that before. So I'm a PhD student, by the way, at Imperial, in my final year, and I'm going to be talking about chemical remanent magnetizations, specifically looking at whether they actually reliably record direction information in nature. So in order to test this, we need to look at localities where we know we have a CRM recorded, and we know that that CRM is recorded a recent field, which hasn't really been done before. So a quick reminder about why we care so much about direction information. The main application of CRMs is in paleo sector variation studies. So this is looking at how the Earth's geomagnetic field has kind of varied on without flipping. And a lot of these studies look at lake sediments because lake sediments have these very high accumulation rates, which means that we get a very high resolution variation study. And a lot of lake sediments or sea sediments are actually recording CRMs. So this example on the right is a recent study using dead sea sediments where to improve the paleosecularization modeling in the Middle East. And this is actually using a CRM that's been carried by greigite. So just kind of this little project was just kind of to ground truth the fact that, yeah, we're using all these CRMs for all these directional studies, but you know, we haven't said for sure that it's definitely reliable. So the reliability of TRMs or thermoremanent magnetizations and detrital remanent magnetizations has been tested in the past. TRMs were tested on recent lavas and DRMs have been tested on river sediments, but CRMs haven't. But theoretically, we would expect a CRM to record the direction of the magnetic field. So I'm going to very briefly kind of explain why that is. I think this is probably quite old news to a lot of people here. If we're looking at a simple case of CRM acquisition, so when we have a grain growth CRM, when our magnetic grains are very small, those magnetic moments are going to be rotating randomly. But then once they reach their blocking volume, a certain size, they no longer have that energy to rotate. And the energy barriers associated with being aligned closer to the field are going to be less than away from the field. Therefore, we'd expect more to be aligned closer in their final state than against. Therefore, we should expect that when we have a bias field or an external magnetic field like the Earth's, a CRM should be recording that direction. So although it hasn't been proved in nature, it has been proved in the lab using a range of different minerals. For example, it's been proven for hematite and also for magnetite. So this is an example of a CRM that's been recorded in magnetite, where obviously the magnetic field was applied in this X direction. And you can see that it's aligned quite well. And this was an alteration CRM, but it was altered from a non-magnetic precursor, and it still seems to. So in order to test this theory, we need to find a location where we have magnetic minerals that are being produced orthogenically, at kind of the present day ideally. And we also need it to be recent so that we know the magnetic field. And we went to Norfolk to some salt marshes where this is happening. And this was thanks to Andrew Roberts' guidance and suggestion of a locality. And what we have is you have these salt marshes which are just inland of the intertidal kind of sands. And these are basically just really boggy, muddy, vegetated marshes with these kind of creeks that run all the way through them. So you can see them all the way down here. And in these, because you get this influx of this seawater every day, you end up with this anoxic layer just below the high tide line, which is perfect. Because it's seawater, you get all of these like loads of iron and sulfur being brought in all the time, which is the perfect conditions for greigite to form. And greigite has been previously found in studies which have looked at these exact sediments in the last kind of 60 years or so. So you can see here you get these black sediments as soon as you remove this surface layer. And the particular reason why this particular location was so great is you can actually see if you look at satellite imagery that these lower marshes have only existed with these present day creeks and kind of locations within the last 70 years or so. So we kind of know that we're recording Earth's current field direction for within the last 70 years. So to test this, obviously we need to collect orientated samples in the field. And then we needed to check that we actually have found some magnetic minerals. And then whether or not these are in domain states which could be reliably recording and retaining a magnetic remnants. I'll obviously need to do our directional analysis to check that, or to see if the directional information is stable and if it's aligned with the Earth's magnetic field. So we sampled, mainly our sampling focused in the lower marshes, basically because we knew that this locality was the youngest. And the upper marshes have existed for potentially a few thousand years, but again, not in their current state. So I think these would also be fine, but we wanted to focus on where we know that it's the youngest sediment. And also this is where people had gone before and found greigite. So you can see here, this is what, like, one of the sediment layers that we sampled. Not the best photography. So now looking at our results. So there was two parts to this. One was finding out if we do have greigite and what our magnetic carriers are. And the second part is to determine whether or not we have our directions. So firstly, let's look at our magnetic mineralogy or domain states. So these four diagrams, this one is the most common, and this was what most of our lower marsh sediments look like. And if I assume this is greigite, which I've done a lot of other work on why I think it's greigite and not other minerals, which I'll discuss later, I think this could be interactive single domain supramagnetic, but I do understand that it could also be pseudo single domain. Obviously, yeah, there's a lot of, it's open to interpretation, but either way, I would say that that could retain a stable magnetization. It's not just supramagnetic. And there's definitely some magnetic stuff there. And we also found that the upper marshes have this much more single domain-like structure. This is the best sample we got because due to other ones altering in air, because I should have mentioned earlier, greigite is not stable, it's an iron sulfide, and it's N members pyrite. So we had to store these samples in nitrogen as soon as we took them out of the ground. So we did have some alteration issues in a few samples. So we see that we have a single domain. So my potential idea is that when we have the lower marsh, we're getting these kind of, because we get this inundation all the time, we've only got very small grains because it's such a changing environment. However, in the upper marshes, it could be a bit more stable. So our grains, magnetic minerals, may be growing to slightly larger sizes and then increasing in coercivity and becoming more single domain-like. This is all quite new work, so it's all a lot of working things. But again, takeaway from the slide is I think we do have stable magnetic carriers. And then we need to try and work out what these magnetic minerals are. Is it greigite or is it goethite or something different? So when we did our AFD magnetization on our NRM, we found that above fields of 40 millitesla, we lose the stable magnetization and we get a gyro-remanent magnetization. And because we did tumbling AFD mag, this just became random in direction. And this is no longer a decrease in intensity. And this is kind of what we would expect to see with single domain greigite, which kind of fits with what we saw from our fault diagrams. And obviously we wanted to actually find some magnetic minerals in there, not using magnetic techniques. So we looked at SEM, and then we combined this with EDX to try and determine what magnetic minerals we had. And the most important thing was we didn't find any iron oxides in our samples. Whenever we had iron, it was always associated with sulfur. So we had lots of iron sulfides, but no iron oxides. Which I think is quite interesting about these samples. And we found a mixture of phamboids and also just pretty really well-defined euhedral, quite large grains that were kind of pyrite. And to differentiate between the two, we attempted to use the iron to sulfur ratio. And we found that some of our phamboids had more greigite-like ratios, and then some of our phamboids looked more like pyrite. So I think that we have a mixture of greigite and pyrite within these samples, but we didn't see any single domain or individual grains of greigite, which might be because there just wasn't enough in our samples, because our magnetizations are quite low. But it could also be because the grains might be too small for the resolution on our microscope. It was about the best resolution on this microscope is about 10 nanometers. It's a tabletop one. It's not the best, actually. Yeah. So bringing that all together, our fault diagrams and our xylophil plots suggest that we've got single domain greigite present, whereas our SEM suggests that we've got phamboidal greigite, or a mixture of the two. And my potential idea about why, so further evidence for this idea of a mixture of single domain greigite and phamboidal greigite came from when we tried to impart a saturating isothermal remnants into our samples. So when we did this, we found that the ratio between our NRM and SIRM was really low, about 0.3%. We modeled the same scenario using our CRM model, and we'd expect something about 3% order of magnitude larger. And this is also similar to what's been seen for previous experimental and modelling studies looking at iron, well, looking at iron oxides with similar saturation magnetizations and properties, like magnetite, for example, you always get an NRM to SRM ratio, which was an order of magnitude larger than what we saw in these samples. And we think that a potential reason for this might be that when we acquire our NRM, we have a very low bias field in the Earth's field, which means that within these really interacting families, we might not be recording the magnetic directions very well due to the interactions being larger. So we think that a weak NRM may be being carried by the single domain names that are present. Whereas when we saturate our sample, we could also be saturating those fanboys, which means that we've got a strong SRM, which is carried by the SD grains and the fanboys, which might be explaining this difference in magnitude. So this is kind of all fitting in with our theory that we've got single domain greigite, which could be recording the magnetization quite well. And we also find that we have a reasonably consistent direction throughout all our samples. So this is our site level analysis. NA, we only got one sample that wasn't altered. So I'm afraid I haven't got a confidence switch on that, so not ideal. But this is kind of the samples that we've got so far, and we can see that we have kind of got an average direction between them. And if we overlay this with the average direction of the Earth's field over the last 70 years, we can see that the mean NRM direction of our samples kind of aligns with it, or close to it, which was pretty good, which shows that we think our NRM is a CRM recorded by greigite, and we think that it's reliably recording the Earth's magnetic field direction, which is what we hoped and expected to find. And in order to kind of think about our samples more and to test this theory of whether we have got a single domain is carrying the magnetization and then the fanboys are carrying the SIRM, we want to import an ARM into these samples. And we want to see if we get a much more, because the ARM is going to be a low field, therefore we'd expect the ARM to also be carried by similar grades to the NRM. So if we get a much more sensible NRM to ARM ratio, that might explain what's going on our samples, and it might suggest that we do have this fanboidal theory and make a bit more sense about these samples, to be honest. Yeah, thank you for listening. Any questions?
Great, thank you. Yes, I have a question.
You shall.
You said right at the start that you've got CRM, you wrote in the blocking volume, right? And then it locks in direction. Do you think it matters if it's a growth CRM versus an alteration CRM? Like, does a blocking volume always apply, or are there going to be cases where actually that's not necessarily the best thing to
I don't think it would be the same. I guess so I haven't really thought about this before. It was something I was hoping to think about, but I haven't got round to it yet. I've mainly focused on grain growth CRM, but I think the energy barriers would probably might be quite similar, but it might, you're not going to be able, I wouldn't imagine that you'd be able to switch, and they wouldn't be equally optional, I guess. Yeah, I don't know, it'd be an interesting thing to model. I don't know if you can do it in Merrill or anything, but I can't do it in my model.
One more question.
Does the difference between the average and the CRM and the direction recorded alter kind of the errors that you're looking at when we're looking back at these, like, various systems in the past?
Yeah, that's a really good point. So, if you look at the studies that have been done early on, like back at the beginning, you can see that the resolution that they've got in their model, sorry, the resolution they've got in their data is kind of the same level as the error that I've got in my measurements, which I'm very aware of, which I think is partly to do with the samples weren't perfectly orientated in the field due to difficulties taking the measurements, and it wasn't the sole purpose of the trip. This is like a little a side project that we did. So I feel like, in general, I think it's quite good, but also because we have quite a high inclination. If you look at our samples, our inclinations are all reasonably similar, kind of in this sphere here. It's our declination where we've got our error, which I think is because we have a higher inclination component and also due to issues orientating the samples. But then also, you know, you do always get quite a large bit of data. Like, for example, in this perfect magnetite example here where they applied huge fields, they also got quite a large spur. But yeah, it is a bit important to note.
We have a question from Wynne online.
Oh, I put my hand down because I thought I was asking too many questions, to be honest, but I do.
You can ask as many as you like, Wynne.
Thank you very much. Okay, so I'll take over the rest of the afternoon. Even if there was a really nice question, but just suddenly occurred to me, I was just thinking, you know, about chemical remanences, to what, to the extent to which you can identify a CRM that is completely new, or one that maybe has inherited a remnant from its parent mineral. So particularly with the framboidal material, I don't expect you necessarily to have an answer to this. I'm just kind of curious, I'm trying to think aloud really of the what might happen if you have a process where you have a dissolution maybe of some parent material that's leaving smaller particles that are somehow like look like framboids, then there's a chance then that what you might be seeing is maybe inherited remnants from the original material, may not be a CRM. Have you thought about that, or does it matter to you whether the CRM is a real CRM or somehow inherited from a previous state?
Yeah, I think it matters quite a lot. It's something we've thought about, and we're still kind of thinking about the influence that these massive framboids are going to be having on our CRMs, because that's, you know, we don't think they're going to be reliably recording the Earth's field, but they could be influencing the other fields that we're measuring. And yeah, it's something that I'm still thinking of, actually. I don't actually have an answer for you on that yet.
Okay, great. Thanks.
That's it?
Yeah. So, you know, in one of the slides where you talk about the remnant carriers,
is that
where you say it's a combination of SD particles plus framboids, maybe the next one.
This one.
The next.
Oh, yeah.
So, when you talk about the NRM to SARM ratio, and one of them you say is a combination of SD grains and framboids, and one just SD grains. So, how do we know that? Could it be possible that the strong SARM is just because there are more SD particles in absolute numbers compared to the weak signal you're getting?
So the reason why I think I might have two different types of grains is because the NRM, even though like we know what the Earth's field is, the NRM should not be as weak as it is compared to the SIRM. So as you increase the number of single domain grains, you're also going to be increasing the NRM as well as the SIRM. Obviously, the SIRM will be much larger, but it's an order of magnitude lower than been seen before in experiments.
That makes some kind of sense to me.
Yeah.
Imagine how the CRM framework, the individual particles collected together.
Yeah, that's actually
the interactions. You know, you can imagine the NRM created in a framework being quite low. But obviously you can then magnetize it a lot. So.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, but I haven't modeled this yet. So.
Seems to make sense. Anyway, thank you.